This October, Show Random takes over.
It's a So Random Halloween special!
Be there and beware. Sunday, October 17th at 8, 7 Central on Disney Channel.
Welcome, one and all, to our very first seasonally appropriate spooky Halloween episode of Escape from Walt Disney, the podcast where we review movies, TV shows, and short films available on the Disney Plus streaming service, chosen mostly completely at random. I am your host, Tony Goldmark, and joining us via Zoom, all the way from Anaheim, California, Kevin Anderson.
I thought this was going to be about Van Helsing. God damn it, you tricked me again.
All the way from Greensboro, North Carolina, Ryan Hipp.
We gonna get spoopy up in this mug.
And joining us for the very first time on Escape from Walt Disney, all the way from Cumberland, Rhode Island, you know her from the podcast channel KRT. You know her from such Twitter feeds as No Context TGIF and No Context Harley Quinn. And you know her as a world-class professional Yorkie wrangler. Please welcome Randee Martin!
I don't actually exist. You're all hallucinating right now.
And this week, for our first ever seasonally appropriate Halloween special, we are covering Sonny with a Chance, Season 2, Episode 18, a So Random Halloween special. Now, does anyone know anything about Sonny with a Chance?
Nope.
All I can see is that this does not look good.
Well, it's a Disney Channel sitcom from It's a Laugh production, so it'd be weird if it did look good.
I watched That So Raven, so I kind of watched the genesis of this type of show, but everything else was kind of after my time.
I grew up half and half with this. First half of the show, I was still in the demographic of watching Disney Channel, so I did see some of it. I actually saw Demi Lovato live in concert.
Oh, Demi Lovato's in this show?
Yeah, she's the star.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, what Hannah Montana was to Miley Cyrus, this was to Demi Lovato.
Exactly, okay. Yep. Oh. I kind of just always fell for whichever Disney Channel girl was on TV at the time. It was definitely a crush, but I thought, me not knowing what gay is, I just thought I really, 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 really wanted to be best friends with these girls.
You know, I just realized I'm the only hetero person on this episode, aren't I?
It's a real nightmare. The homosexuals and the queer people are taking over.
Our gay agenda this whole time was just to take over this specific podcast.
I would have aimed a little higher, but you know, what do I know? I'm into girls.
Gotta start somewhere, Tony.
What can I say, Tony? You're becoming a gay icon.
Oh, awesome. I've always wanted to be one of those.
Now all you gotta do is wear a meat dress.
I've probably heard a Demi Lovato song or two, but I couldn't tell you the name of them.
Cool for the Summer.
Cool for the Summer, right. I remember that. That was a big summer jam a few years ago, back when summer existed. She also do the end credits version of Let It Go.
Yes, she did.
I think she did. That's right.
The inferior one that was not as good as Idina Menzel's version in the movie. Like, the Demi Lovato version was clearly meant to be the big radio single, but then the actual Idina Menzel version of Elsa singing it was a much bigger radio single, so the end credits version literally had no reason to exist.
So I imagine Demi Lovato can actually manage to hit the high notes, so there's a big difference.
Well,
there,
so can Idina Menzel. It's just that the wickedly talented Adele Dazeem apparently can't. So let me read the description of the overall show. Sonny has won a nationwide talent search to star in So Random, a popular television series. She moves from Wisconsin with her mom, Connie, and prepares for a new chapter in her life. Sonny with a Chance follows her work and home life and how she adjusts to her new life. She makes friends quickly with her fellow castmates Nico, Grady, and Zora, while the show's star, Tawny, makes forging a friendship more difficult than Sonny was prepared for.
Did this just, like, prophesize my life this year?
I guess so, yeah. Although it's COVID that's made forging friendships more difficult than you were prepared for.
That's true.
Yay!
So the episode we got is, of course, a So Random Halloween special, so is this like those episodes of 30 Rock where they would just do them live from New York, like SNL style, where it's just the show within a show presented as the show?
Pretty
possibly
much. It basically plays into, you know, the childhood fantasy of finally being an All That cast member 20 years after All That was relevant.
I was gonna say, this seems to have a very All That vibe to it.
Have the creators of this show ever heard of iCarly? This seems like it's Disney's answer to iCarly.
It might be.
I really wouldn't be shocked.
I've never seen iCarly either. Does that have a similar premise?
It's about a girl hosting a show, and I have no idea if So Random actually is an appropriate descriptor for the show within the show here, but iCarly, the show itself within the show, is supposed to be a really random web show thing.
iCarly is basically another childhood power fantasy about becoming a super famous viral web show host.
See, I was way too old for all this shit.
Same.
And iCarly happened to be a Dan Schneider production, who was kind of the Nickelodeon equivalent of It's a Laugh, but presumably Disney didn't have a creepy foot fetishist running the show, so.
Hey, we don't know that yet.
I've heard the name Dan Schneider, and thank God we're not covering one of his shows.
Funny enough, Dan Schneider is responsible for all that.
Oh, really?
And another fun fact, David Archuleta actually did a guest episode on one of those, and that got him popular with that age demographic. So guess who the opening act for Demi Lovato was when I saw her?
David Archuleta.
Jesus Christ.
David Archuleta.
I have no idea who he is.
He was an American Idol winner who was famous for like 5 minutes.
So basically every American Idol winner.
Yeah.
Adam Lambert sang for Queen, but anyways, we're getting off track.
Did he win though?
No.
It's always the people who lose who wind up becoming the big stars, and the people who win we never hear from again.
Yeah, Jennifer Hudson won an Oscar. That's how big she became. And meanwhile, who even won that year? The only winner who really went on to anything was Kelly Clarkson.
And she was the first.
She was the first, yep. Yeah.
It worked the one time, and then it was all downhill from there.
Where's Justin Guarini, Yoki?
Bringing things back around, in relation to all that Nick stuff from the 90s, it says Shaquille O'Neal hosts a Halloween special in the description.
Yeah, the description of the episode just says Shaquille O'Neal hosts a Halloween special.
Watch out for the Shaq attack. Oh, I told you to watch out.
I am officially a grumpy old man. I was well into high school when this aired. I think actually I might have been in college by the time this aired. So was Shaq still a thing at this time? I feel like this was past when he was really doing anything besides Icy Hot commercials.
Shaq has never really not been a thing. I was shocked a few years ago. I looked to see when he actually quit the NBA, and I was shocked at how soon it was, because toward the end, he just kept jumping through teams. I think his last team was the Cavaliers the first couple of years that LeBron was with them. Shaq has stayed relevant. He hosts NBA coverage for TNT and TBS, and he does all those commercials, like The General, of course.
Didn't Shaq do a bunch of commercials for a cruise line a while back?
He did.
I wouldn't be surprised.
I remember one time I caught an episode of, I think, Colbert, where Charles Barkley was the guest, and they're talking about some of the commercials Charles Barkley's done, and Colbert brought up Shaq, and Charles Barkley just said, Shaq will endorse anything. Literally anything.
Shaq and Charles Barkley are kind of frenemies that way. There's a lot back and forth between them. I think they both host the TNT NBA coverage.
Right.
There's a lot of things he did that were failed business ventures that kind of became ironically loved by hipsters, like Kazam.
Kazam is on Disney Plus, so we might end up covering that one of these days.
Oh, and then there was that video game, Shaq-Fu.
Yeah.
Which I do own for Sega Genesis, and it is... It exists. It's definitely a video game.
And he had a fucking rap career.
There was Steel.
He had something called Shaq Life, which was a reality show. It was on TNT, even though it probably should have been a TBS show. I saw one episode one time, and what I had no idea of until I watched it, it was narrated by Sam Jackson. And it was nuts. Sam Jackson just cuts in and says really weird things. It's Shaq going on tour as a DJ, and one of his roadies is complaining about having bad gas. And so Sam Jackson cuts in and is yelling, TMI, man, TMI.
I feel like Shaquille O'Neal got lucky because his name is just so catchy and fun to say that it's impossible for him to be irrelevant.
I'm looking at this thumbnail they have, and it's some kind of like creepy Muppet face paint mascot thing.
I thought we were watching Sunny with a Chance. Why are we putting on the Where the Wild Things Are movie?
What are we in for?
This is probably going to unlock some seriously repressed memories.
Demi Lovato and Shaquille O'Neal on screen together. For the first time, it's like watching rock and roll history taking place, man.
It's the history of something.
I was actually there, man. Shaquille O'Neal and Demi Lovato in the same room.
You kids today with your music, in my day we had real music. We had Shaquille O'Neal and Demi Lovato.
You know, those two.
God help us all.
We will be right back with our thoughts on Sonny with a Chance, Season 2, Episode 18, a So Random Halloween special featuring Shaquille O'Neal, right here on our special seasonally appropriate Halloween episode of Escape from Walt Disney.
We about to get shacked, y'all.
Come on home. See what's waiting for you.
Okay, we just watched Sonny with a Chance, Season 2, Episode 18, a So Random Halloween special. That was dumb. That was pretty bad. Barely a sketch show, and could barely have had less to do with Halloween.
It doesn't work as a sketch show because it's painfully not funny.
There's no spontaneity to it whatsoever. You can tell every line is these kids just being force-fed, just say it this way, get it right this time.
You would think a show called So Random.
I mean, supposedly the whole point of this show is that these sketches are supposed to be light, wacky little bursts of absurdism, and I've never seen anything that was supposed to be light and weird and wacky. Instead, feels so tight and stringent and forced and no fun.
It's clearly Disney Channel trying to take a stab at the Amanda Show and all that and all the stuff Nick did. The problem is because Disney is so wholesome, it has no bite to it.
Well, it doesn't even need bite necessarily. Great comedy doesn't always have to be satirical. It just has to be funny. And you can get really good laughs out of just weird, crazy, random, ridiculous absurdism, but it has to be funny. This isn't.
With the all that comparison, I noticed as soon as they stepped backstage into that green room set, that is literally the set from All That.
They're not even hiding it.
That looks almost identical.
It's the set from All That combined with Pee-wee's Playhouse. It was just so yes. Ridiculously ostentatious.
This thing I've realized about Disney Channel, both the movies and the TV shows, is their design has all the loud colors.
Yeah.
Loud, vibrant, bold colors everywhere on the sets and the costumes.
Every color not found in nature.
It's not just that a unicorn threw up, it's like a unicorn took ecstasy at a rave and then threw up.
And meanwhile, their actual set on the show is just like a cube. It's just someone standing in a cube that's decorated with Halloween shit.
Basically like if Laugh-In's joke wall imploded on itself.
And then they go backstage and it's these lavish fucking couches and all this multicolored bullshit.
And it's only on screen for like 15 seconds total, then they're right back out into the cube.
I mean, I have to imagine that that's the main set of the main show when they're doing the sitcom Sonny with a Chance.
Yeah.
But here's my question. That opening bit where they can't find Shaq, was that supposed to take place in the sketch show or in the sitcom? Was it supposed to be a quote-unquote real in-universe onset mishap from the sitcom version of the world? Or was that a stage sketch for the sketch show within a show that is the entire show of this episode? Because I would accept either answer. All That did backstage sketches too.
Yes.
Honestly, I don't know.
It felt like an All That thing, because if that was the show breaking the show within a show to be the sitcom, that would have been the only time the entire episode, because everything else that episode was framed as the So Random show. So I think that was supposed to be a sketch for the show within the show, which, by the way, I think we can all agree, we have 8 feet of dew to find is the line of the episode, right? I think we can all agree.
8 feet of dew.
Too easy.
The dude is 8 feet tall. How do you lose 8 feet of dude?
Some of the writing, I was like, where is the joke? The one that really hit to me was the something and a werewolf walk into a juice bar.
The werewolf and a lawyer.
Right, and I'm like, where is the joke? Is this just priest and a rabbi?
I think that was the joke because they cut away. I think the idea is that she's doing her bad stand-up comedy, so she starts her joke and it's just nonsense and then they cut away.
That's another point for the backstage mishap being just a sketch, because they push her out onto the stage and she suddenly got a flashlight?
Yeah.
If they didn't mean for that to happen, where the hell did she get the flashlight? flashlight to shine in her face and tell the fucking ghost story that turns out to be a priest and a rabbi bullshit.
One thing that bothered me about the flashlight thing is how she shines the flashlight directly on her face.
Yeah.
The scary thing is you put it under.
Put it under and shine it upwards. Not like blind yourself.
You talk about her misusing the flashlight. Does the frontman for All-Star Weekend not know how to use a microphone? Because it was nearly a foot away from his face, pointed toward the ceiling. By the way, am I supposed to know who they are?
No.
Is that actually a thing?
Disney tried to make them a thing. They basically look like someone tried to clone the Jonas Brothers in a lab and something went horribly wrong.
Oh, yeah.
And I looked this up. Their debut album, which was released right around the time of this special, climbed all the way up to number 197 on the Billboard 200.
Wow.
Well, whoa. They technically charted. Not everyone can do that.
They're not Vampire Weekend.
Although they were introduced by Shaq as a vampire.
I ask if they're real because that song sounded like a made-up song. I've come down with love.
Feelings.
The use of autotune was comical. Stuff he could have done with his inflection. They were auto-tuning.
Yeah.
Like, it felt like a fake auto-tune joke.
There was auto-tune all over this show.
Oh,
they auto-tuned the fucking redneck roadkill song.
Oh, God.
My first instinct watching all of this is to say, this feels like a parody of sketch shows. This feels like an intentionally bad on-purpose sketch show that you'd see on a sitcom to make fun of how dumb sketch shows are. And then I realized that's literally what this is.
Yeah.
This is an intentionally bad sketch show within a sitcom that they mercilessly stretched out to 22 minutes without bothering to make it good.
This might be giving it too much credit, but since it's the show within a show, I'm wondering if it's supposed to be like a meta thing that since it's a sketch within the show, the joke is the lack of joke. Like, it's a dumb sketch, and that's the joke.
I could accept that if the sketches weren't the whole episode.
Yeah.
If this was just dumb sketches within what's supposed to be a sitcom, fine. Then the quality all depends on how good the sitcom is. Like 30 Rock, for example, the sketches they did on the girly show were never actually good. They were just making fun of SNL.
Fart machines made too many farts.
But here, if you're taking that plunge and saying, okay, the sketches are the show now, you've got to step up your game. You've got to have more there, even if it is bad on purpose. Even if you are just doing an elaborate meta-commentary on how bad sketch shows are, you've still got to put the extra effort into making sure the audience knows it's bad on purpose and that's the joke. Like what Neil Hamburger does. Neil Hamburger does bad on purpose better than just about anyone, and this show is no fucking Neil Hamburger. And that's even if it's bad on purpose. I think you're right. It is giving them too much credit. I don't think they were thinking that high at all. It was literally just, the dumb kids who watch this show seem to like these dumb sketches. Let's just do the dumb sketches.
Maybe they weren't thinking because they were high.
I was one of those dumb kids, and I just realized watching this that it was around the time of this show airing that I started to lose interest in Disney Channel.
Mm-hmm.
Watching the show again, I'm like, now I can see where I pinpoint losing interest in Disney
this
Channel.
This was the moment. This was where the paths diverged.
The It's a Laugh Disney Channel shows and the Dan Schneider Nickelodeon shows, they had the most obnoxious laugh tracks.
They did,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, God, yeah.
During the entire All-Star Weekend show, you have like the girls screaming plug-in sound effect.
I hate that sound.
Which I distinctly remember iCarly had, I think it was the plain white tees on, and they did the exact same thing. I get having the screams at the beginning and the end, but having it throughout the entire song to remind people, hey, this is, quote, in front of an audience. Let's remind you the entire time.
Yeah, when the Beatles were on Ed Sullivan, the audience didn't scream that much. I call bullshit.
It kind of has this air of it's trying too hard to be funny. Like, they are trying so hard. You can't just make fetch happen.
They're simultaneously trying too hard and not hard enough, because the sketches themselves feel like something someone tossed off in an instant.
They literally stole from Animaniacs.
The fucking Halloween do's and don'ts sketches.
That is vital information.
Vital information on all that was kind of that, but it was more good idea, bad idea from Animaniacs.
Right, yeah. That too.
Just the dumbest fucking punchlines, like, it's good to bob for apples. It's not good to apples for Bob because Bob has braces and he'll yell at you for wanting to get apple in his braces. What? There are people named Bob who don't have braces. What
I get the, you know, don't carve onions because that's universal, but the Bob, that's...
You know what's sad? Do carve pumpkins, don't carve onions was easily the best Halloween do's yeah. and don'ts segment just because it was technically a joke, even if it was pure highlights for kids bullshit.
I specifically wrote down the name of the third one because it was that bad. Tell ghost stories, don't tell toast stories.
I distinctly remember that on Kenan and Kel.
When the bread popped out of the toaster, no one knew what to put on it.
He said, let's tell ghost stories, not toast stories.
Kenan and Kel and also SpongeBob.
Ghosts!
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 Toast.
Ghost!
And he tells the story about the toast being burnt to a crisp, but when he holds up the toast, that's
it's
perfect.
It's just a good piece of toast. Yeah. It's not burned or anything.
It's like the perfect ratio of crisp.
Meanwhile, in the other recurring segment, boy, those checkout girls were obnoxious.
I wanted to strangle those two annoying valley girls. I'm like, this is just painful. I hate
Again,
you both.
Again, where's the joke, actually?
Yes!
Because the whole premise is just these two fucking ditzy Trader Joe's checkout clerks who just talk like Moon Unit Zappa as Valley Girl. They just do the Valley Girl voice and that's the joke.
Misogyny, that's the joke.
That voice was funny for maybe 30 seconds in 1982 when Moon Unit Zappa started doing it, and then instantly it became played out and just annoying.
The witch shows up at the checkout girls. It's a Karen who's legit
yeah.
a witch this time.
She literally says, I want to speak to your manager.
Yeah.
To be fair, the Wicked Witch of the West was the OG Karen with
she
how
really
willing
was.
She was to kill a child over a pair of shoes.
Yep.
When she did her magic spell and there's like that little cheap plug-in explosion special effect, I kind of hope that there was just the explosion and that was it.
She fucking died.
Just blew them up.
I'm a size zero.
Oh, fuck that.
Yeah, she fucking shrinks them instead. It's like, okay, congratulations. You've proved you have a green screen.
Can we talk about that monster skit?
Oh, the monster skit with fucking HR Trump and stuff? What the It literally looked like Trump dressed as fucking a Where the Wild Things Are, HR Puff and Stuff looking motherfucker.
The monster wanted to use the internet, which is weird because monsters don't use internet because monsters.
He comes out from under her bed and the first thing he wants to do is log on to social media, so he is Trump.
His whole existence is to troll this little girl.
It's not even on the level of trolling. It's literally just the monster comes from under the bed and says, ooh, a computer. Just
yeah.
don't see those anywhere.
There's no joke here. It's just stupid.
What is joke?
Monsters, Inc. is really scraping the bottom of the barrel with these new recruits.
These jokes feel like...
They're not jokes. They're barely fucking jokes.
Some high-paid Disney executive in a suit on his golden toilet or whatever... Watched like
Who are these
three
people?
Episodes of all that and like half an episode of iCarly and is like, oh, okay, I get what kids like these days.
The sketches are so flimsy, you actually start feeling a little sorry for the crew. Like, oh my god, someone actually built a set for this? What the fuck?
Well, most of those sets looked like they could have been for anything. The kids' bedroom, the living room for the Halloween party.
Also, where the hell are the adults? Are there any adults running this show?
Where's your mother?
Are there any other stage crew for that matter?
Are there any adult producers or anything? Is anyone directing this shit? Is this Lord of the Flies?
So the opening of the show where they're doing all the cast members like their SNL style opening and they open the doors and all the people are like dancing or doing something.
Right.
Am I crazy or was the big kid with the bowl cut, was he going ape shit with like a blind person cane? Am I losing my mind, or is that what he had in his hand?
Maybe?
They open the door, and he's doing the Star Wars kid thing where he's twisting a stick around, and it looked like one of those white canes that blind people use.
Do you think he took it from a blind person?
I don't know. That's what it looked like. I'm just hoping I'm not losing my mind.
That'd be more interesting.
I just wonder if either the kid had a sick sense of humor, or if, like, a PA... had a twisted sense of humor and did that? I don't know. I want it to be. I really want this Disney Channel show just randomly for 2 seconds. A kid's twisting around a blind person cane for no reason at all.
Is it me, or could these kids just not decide what they were dressed as for Halloween? Like, even outside the sketches, they kept changing costumes.
Every time they cut to the, I'm just going to call it the good idea, bad idea segments.
Right.
Those are some of the worst Halloween costumes I've ever seen. Like, I've seen better at Spirit Halloween, at Party City.
I've seen better at the dollar store.
The best costumes were the wigs they put on Shaq.
Also, Shaq was barely in this.
Yeah.
A tragic lack of Shaq.
I'll give him a little more credit than that. I thought he was going to be in it less than he actually was. I was surprised at how much he was in it, honestly.
He was in one sketch! He was in the opening, and then he introduced all the Halloween do's and don'ts, and then he was Shaq-ula in that one scene, and he introduced the two songs, like he's the SNL host. Otherwise, he was nowhere in this.
I thought he was just going to be maybe the opening and maybe the very end, and that was it, but they managed to get Shaq in a makeup chair and make Shaq-ula happen. At least we can say Shaq-ula now.
Shaq-ula, yeah.
It's on record, and it happened.
That whole Shaq-ula concept, I feel like if it was given to better writers,
yeah,
something really good could have come out of it.
I feel like if they were to go all out with Shaq-ula, that's something that a Mad TV or an SNL or maybe even all that would have done, and they would have done like a blaxploitation parody.
Right.
But since it's a Disney Channel, they probably didn't have the balls.
They didn't have the basketballs.
Hey!
Oh.
I want to talk about the opening sketch with the backstage shenanigan. He was totally jacking off in that photo booth, right?
Hold on now.
He was shacking off.
Shacking
off, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. I'll be here all week.
You just made a better joke than this entire show.
I mean, we can end the show now, right? You just needed to get that out of the way.
Sure, why not?
But if we're being honest with ourselves, I get it. It's for the joke, but Shaq doesn't need to jack off. He's Shaq.
Yeah.
He doesn't need to do that.
There was a woman in there with him. I don't know where she went.
I did like his line in that scene. I'm a big man with big feelings, okay? This episode did have its moments. I also liked the line on the two checkout girls, because this is my kind of joke, like the anti-joke thing where they said, check out his football. Who does he think he is? Tony Hawk? That's not the kind of joke I would make. I like that.
Ryan, just because it's a joke you would make doesn't make it good. Sorry.
Why is the NBA All-Star, who has done countless live, crowded NBA games and public appearances and press conferences,
and had a rap career where he's rapping in front of audiences,
and now he goes on like this dumb little children's sketch show, and now he has stage fright?
I think that adds to the theory that that sketch is a sketch within the show, within the show.
Also adding to it, the fact that he doesn't actually do a monologue?
No.
So before Shaq can go on stage, he has to do this pre-show ritual with all the kids in the cast and some kid named Chad who's not in the cast.
Oh, that was like another show within the show. There was like this rivalry between the dumb sketch comedy and the Dawson's Creek teen drama.
Oh, God.
So that was the Mackenzie whatever.
That's what that was. Okay.
Yeah.
So anyway, after they do the thing, Shaq asks, can I keep the suit? And the kids say, you can keep Chad. Wait, what?
You know, this show was made in a more innocent time when you have kids throwing around the word Chad like it's nothing.
Oh, man.
And then during his non-monologue, Shaq looks at the camera and says, we got a great show. Don't go anywhere. Especially you, Chad.
Shaq predicted the word Chad becoming a thing in 2020.
You're ignoring the most important part of this, which is that this is a child prostitution ring. They're just giving Shaq, the fucking kid from the Dawson's Creek show, to placate him. In universe, who's the Dan Schneider of this show? Like, that would be the really dark take on this material.
Where's QAnon on this one?
Oh, no.
Hey, Shaq has a Q in his name. What do you think?
Oh. It's all connected.
Holy shit.
Shaq-QAnon O'Nuanon.
There it is.
The last two big sketches that aren't just Halloween do's and don'ts or the checkout girls, neither of those have anything to do with Halloween. It's the fucking roadkill sketch and the fucking smooth jam about wanting to scare babies.
I want to make babies cry.
Can we talk about that?
I thought making babies cry was kind of great, actually.
That was the only part of that show that made me laugh even just a little.
The execution of that song was almost enough to save it, just because they nailed that R. Kelly auto-tune slow jam type of thing. Speaking of child prostitution rings, yeah. R. Kelly, sorry.
The dude is clearly dressed, supposed to be Neo.
Neo, excellent. Much less cringe-inducing. So they nailed the style of those kinds of songs, and that it's about some crazy guy who likes making babies scream. What ruined it, though? What fucking torpedoed it for me was cutting to the cast members fucking dressed as babies.
Yeah.
It was so unsettling. It completely destroyed any laugh that sketch could have had.
There's just something deeply horrifying about it.
It kept making me think of, like, Rachel Bloom and Ninja Sex Party and how they've done very similar things with even lower budget, but it's so much better.
Yeah.
Like, I literally put on Pictures of Your Dick by Rachel Bloom after this, just kind of compare, and I'm like, this is so much better, and it has, like, no budget whatsoever.
'Cause all I can do is lay around and post pictures of your dick on the internet. All I can do is sit and cry.
The whole notion of the R&B sexy smooth jam juxtaposed with ridiculous lyrics, that's a solid comic premise, or at least a solid comic format, but I've seen it done way better.
Confessions Part 3.
Yeah, I guess that would count. Butter toast, I dropped and picked up off the floor. So how about that fucking roadkill sketch?
Oh.
Fuck you, all of rural America. This is what we think you are.
I think we can all agree that Roadkill McGill is totally an anti-masker, right?
Definitely. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. He has rats.
In his fucking song, he literally mentioned that he sells flattened, tasty bats. So he started the virus.
Roadkill McGill is patient zero.
He is. Holy shit.
The entire sketch is something they clearly took out of Larry the Cable Guy's garbage can.
This is not the first time that a That's a Laugh sitcom made a joke about Southerners eating roadkill. There was a joke just like that in the Hannah Montana Halloween episode with Miley's evil cousin mentioning Aunt Whatever's roadkill stew. So I think the heads of That's a Laugh just seem to have this weird
stereotype rural America
that Southerners eat roadkill.
This is why they all voted for Trump. This is why they wanted to burn the system down. It's because they're tired of those liberal elites at the Disney Channel
thinking they eat roadkill.
So much for the tolerant left, man.
I'm a proud North Carolinian. Right? I can firmly say we do, in fact, exclusively eat roadkill.
Oh, okay.
What do you think makes our barbecue so famous?
Hey, live off the land, am I right?
I stand corrected, and I apologize to the entire roadkill community.
They make this big deal about, oh, I don't kill them. I just have other people kill them, and then I pick up the carcass.
And the city couple who's disgusted by this, the guy literally has an ascot, and the girl is named Muffy, so they just hate everybody.
I swear, I have seen that exact sweater around the neck and the pink polo shirt, I think it was.
He's dressed as Carlton, basically. Yeah,
or Fred from Scooby-Doo.
They basically hate every type of white Southerner. The preppy rich ones and the rural yeehaw ones.
And again, as a white Southerner, I can say that I also hate white Southerners.
So we mentioned the All-Star Weekend song that's barely a song. Demi Lovato actually sings a song supposedly in character as well. And that song actually wasn't too bad, but the problem with it was that it's called Work of Art, and the lyrics are all about how great it is to be imaginative and creative, and this show is not.
No.
This show is so corporate.
It's like someone saying, do whatever your heart desires. Imagination is limitless. You have worlds to conquer with your creativity. And then their idea of creativity is a fart joke.
I like Cool for the Summer better.
Do as she says, not as she does, I guess.
I might sound crazy saying this, and I can't prove this, but I have the feeling that Sonny's backup band cannot play instruments.
I think so.
There were a couple subtle hints looking at that keyboard player, but I can't be too sure.
They did not look like the session musicians who played on that song.
No.
I noticed she's singing this inspirational, up-tempo pop single, but she has all these Halloween decorations around her. I really wish she came out and did the most kitschiest, silliest Halloween novelty song.
Yeah, yeah. Just fucking sing Monster Mash.
Exactly.
I mean, watching this, I'm thinking, okay, Demi Lovato was probably releasing albums at this point. This song was probably on whichever album she was promoting at the time. I looked it up. That song was made specifically for this show. It is not on any of her albums. It's a fucking rarity deep cut that she just did for this episode.
It honestly sounded like it, though.
Listen, compared to the rest of the show, I'm just grabbing for whatever minuscule microscopic nuggets of anything remotely resembling quality I can grasp.
At the very end, when they were saying their goodbyes, they refer to Shaq as their amazing guest host. Yes, their amazing guest host who couldn't be bothered to close the show.
No, you'd think they'd pull an SNL and at least have him out to wave, but no.
He booked it.
He's in that fucking Pee-wee's Playhouse back room doing unspeakable things to Chad.
I wish they had just recorded that while he was either in a wig or dressed as Shakula, and they just awkwardly pasted him into that closing shot. It's not even remotely convincing. They just threw it in there.
By the way, I used to play bass for Unspeakable Things to Chad.
One of the last lines of the episode is, "No babies or basketball players were harmed during the making of this." And I'm like, you are lying. That had to have been painful to get through. He's just like, I need a paycheck.
Shaq doesn't need a paycheck.
Shaq kind of has that same thing that I feel like Christopher Lloyd and Robin Williams had, where they just did not say no to anything that was thrown at them.
Walk in too.
If you ask them to be in something, they will just straight up do it, no matter how stupid it is.
I love Shaq. Like, I am not really a sports person at all, but he is just so endearing and charming. He gets that he's become a meme. He's just game, and I love him so much.
He crowdfunded a Shaq Fu sequel.
Right.
Definitely a guy who revels in carving out his particular cultural niche. And you gotta love him for that.
This show really feels like a relic of the late 2000s.
This was definitely in like the declining era of television viewership. Some people call it the death of television as YouTube was rising, and now that's where most people are viewing stuff.
Yeah.
Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, and Disney are just fighting over scraps.
Sprinkle in a little bit of that late 2000s lol, so random internet culture while totally missing the point of that internet culture.
Yeah.
Even the show is called So Random.
It's so hard to imagine adults actually getting paid to write this.
Right.
It just feels like that goes against all good sense. Like some scribe in a darkened room just feverishly trying to... Okay, if Bob for apples, but yeah, apple for Bob. Well, why is that bad? Well, he's got braces, and that's the roadkill. I hate everybody.
Apples for
my third marriage.
To give it a little more credit, we now have on camera Shaquille O'Neal saying, apples for Bob.
Apples for Bob.
Yeah, you're right. I take back everything I said.
Imagine being named Bob. If my name was Bob, I would be like, thank you very much, Mr. O'Neal. I will appreciate and cherish these apples for the rest of my life.
But he's saying, don't give apples to Bob. And you know, maybe it's just because we're all old and boring now. Maybe if I saw this when I was a kid, I'd get more out of it, but... I kind of doubt it. I think even as a kid, I would have preferred all that.
I was a kid when this came out. Even though apparently I enjoyed Demi Lovato's music enough that I saw her live. Well, I didn't see her live. I begged my parents to take me. But this show made me lose interest in Disney Channel altogether.
Kevin, earlier you mentioned that the cube set kind of looked like Laugh-In, and I'm sure that was the intended visual reference, but... This show did not have a tenth of the enthusiasm and just energy of Laugh-In. I mean, Laugh-In wasn't the most well-written show, but it had an energy to it, damn it.
Yeah,
and this
it
just
had camp.
Didn't.
It had Richard Nixon.
It had, well, this had the Trump monster, so. Yeah. But otherwise, this is just fucking nothing. It's so fucking lightweight. It's like televised styrofoam.
It reminds me of how some dystopian future predictions are like, there's no food anymore. You just take pills with all the vitamins and nutrients and you don't enjoy it anymore.
Yeah.
This show feels like that, but for comedy.
It feels very synthetic.
I feel like they didn't even need to make a kids show. They could have just had a black screen with the white letters that just say laugh on them. This was like comedy they live. Like you put on the sunglasses and it just says laugh.
To put it in language Ryan might appreciate, this is the sketch comedy equivalent of the Whedon cut. The Snyder cut better fucking have a scene where Cyborg sings a slow jam about how much he loves scaring babies. That's all I'm saying. And that doesn't have that, we riot.
They're shooting some new scenes, so we gotta start the new hashtag. We gotta write our letters now.
Hashtag release the Shaq cut.
Just have Steel show up.
Shaq Snyder. Shaq Snyder.
Hopefully no one was abused on this set of Sunny with a Chance.
Hopefully.
It's a kids show, so you know they were.
We're at the point we've mentioned Epstein, Whedon, Schneider, and Trump. Welcome to our fun Halloween episode, everybody.
Yay!
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Well, what's Halloween without monsters? And speaking of monsters, this next question has nothing necessarily to do with monsters whatsoever. What's the attraction? To my knowledge, there has never been any Sunny with a Chance or So Random representation in the parks, and why in God's name would there be? But of course now, people are going to discover the comedic brilliance of this So Random Halloween special, and it's going to be the most watched thing on Disney Plus. Disney's going to try to work it into the park somehow. How are they going to do it? Ryan.
You know, Savi's Workshop, or whatever it's called at Galaxy's Edge, mm-hmm. You build your own lightsaber. Instead, you build your own blind person cane so you can be the kid from the opening, and people open doors and you're just going nuts with your blind person cane for no reason.
Kevin?
The next live show is just going to be that So Random. Like, they're just going to put it in one of the Hollywood Studios stages. It's going to replace Fantasmic or... Oh, you know what? They're going to replace Frozen at the Hyperion with this.
Randee?
Instead of cast members, every single park employee is going to be the checkout girls. And the only food sold at the parks will be apples, but you can only have the apples if your name is Bob.
But Bob's not supposed to have the apples. I feel like I'm going insane. Just the more I think about this sketch, the more I descend into madness.
Can you get toast if you tell a toast story?
The toast is going to look perfectly normal, but when you bite into it, you're going to taste burnt toast.
Okay.
And you're going to smell burnt toast because you're having a stroke. Unfortunately, you're all wrong, because what they are going to do is they are going to replace the Trump animatronic in the Hall of Presidents with that fucking monster thing. He's going to jump off the stage and just rifle through the audience for people's laptops and log on to Facebook and just spend the whole show dicking around on Facebook.
47 years. Is that a computer?
Yeah, all the fucking presidents are just going to be obsessed with people's computers. So, final verdict, folks. Is Sunny with a Chance... Season 2, Episode 18, a So Random Halloween special, a Disney Plus or a Disney Minus? Randee?
I'm gonna go with Minus.
Kevin?
There is no question in my mind. This is a Disney Minus. If you want something like this, just watch, like, Laugh-In. Watch all that. Watch The Amanda Show. Watch King and Kel. Watch anything
watch
but
SNL.
This.
Watch SNL!
Yes! Ryan?
See, I did not dislike it as much as the rest of you, but I didn't necessarily like it. I thought it was fine. It had its moments. I'm giving it a very mild Disney minus. You could take or leave it. It's there.
I'm going to forget about it in an hour anyway, so I guess it's not the worst thing I've covered for this podcast, but... Disney Minus, there's just no there. There's just nothing to recommend it. Maybe if the writers hadn't been afraid to just be more weird with it. It's the most banal possible version of weird, wacky, and crazy. It's, oh, they're funny because they're doing weird voices or something. If they had really not been afraid to make this cartoony, then maybe you would have had something. As is, it's just bland and dull and forgettable. Anyone got anything they want to plug?
I am on a podcast called Channel KRT. Check that out. I also run 2 No Context Twitter accounts. I run No Context Harley Quinn and No Context TGIF.
As usual, like I always say whenever I'm here, follow me on Twitter at Arthur Knowledge and check out the company I work for, HobbyDB.com.
YouTube.com/internetvideoparty. On the socials, it's Ryan Hipp FTW on Twitter and Instagram. It's just Ryan Hipp on Vero. On Letterboxd, it is Party Times, PARTEETYMZ. And I think that's it.
And you can follow me on Twitter at Tony Goldmark. And you can also follow this show on Twitter at EFVD Podcast. I've also got a Facebook fan group you can join called Some Jerk with a Fan Club. And I've also got a YouTube channel, youtube.com/Tony Goldmark, where you can find all 3 seasons of my web series, Some Jerk with a Camera, along with a bunch of other videos about movies and theme parks, and even a few scant episodes of this very podcast. You can find every episode to this podcast at pipedreampodcast.com, as well as all the usual outlets like iTunes, Spotify, and Google Play. If you like what you've been hearing and you'd like to help us out, please subscribe, please leave a review, please give us 5 stars. All that stuff helps us get discovered by the almighty algorithm. If you'd like to help us out even more, you can donate to my Patreon, patreon.com/Tony Goldmark, where if you pledge any amount, even the bare minimum of $1 a month, you get to hear episodes of this podcast 1 day early on Tuesdays instead of Wednesdays. Once again, that's patreon.com/Tony Goldmark. Special thanks to all my patrons. You don't know how much it means to me, especially in these financially uncertain times. So next week's episode of Escape from Walt Disney will actually not technically be next week's episode, because this Saturday, on Halloween, exactly October 31st, I am going to release next week's episode 4 days early for a double dose of Halloween fun. And joining me right now is one of my guests on that very episode, Gabby Tyrell. How you doing, Gabby?
Ooh, I'm spooky.
Oh, I can tell. So as I mentioned last week, we're feeding a special Halloween shortlist into the randomizer, and I made sure to include absolutely everything from the recommended Halloween collection on Disney Plus right now, regardless of whether I agree that it should count as a Halloween title or not.
Yeah.
So a couple of these are a little questionable, but who am I to argue with Disney Plus's opinion on what Halloween is? So,
right,
with all that in mind, Gabby, are you ready to read off the randomizer's pick?
Yes, sir. Let's get it going.
Okay, Smart House, initiate random shuffle mode, please.
Initiating random shuffle mode.
Make a selection.
And the winner is
Halloween Town 1998.
Halloween Town 1998, the first Halloween Town movie. Okay, join us on Halloween, folks, right here on Escape from Walt Disney, as we cover the original Halloween Town.
Come on home, where your video's playing. Good times are waiting, it's true. Come where your family is waiting for Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you. Walt Disney and you.
An apple? An apple? What's the matter with you? I just got my braces. Why don't you just give me corn on the cob? Or taffy? Or better yet, just call my mom and tell her that $3,000 worth of doctor just got pushed down the toilet because you want to give me an apple.
Bob, chill. You could have just said no.